you're here with us tonight. My friend Carol Bird is here.
Hi, guys.
With me. I wanted to tell you a little bit about Carol. She teaches a women's Sunday school class with me. We talked about that last week. But Carol and I have been giggling at some of you with your notebooks and things because both of us are office supply junkies. And so we're like, our sisters are here with us.
Perfect. That's right.
And the other thing about Carol is she has a Mary Poppins bag and she brings it to our Sunday school class every week. And whenever we need something, Carol has it in the bag. It's just like Mary Poppins. It's great. Hey, we're so excited about all of you who are here. I just watched in wonder, and my nation's loving heart was just so warmed last week to see how many countries are represented in our group. This week, we added Australia and Scotland. We added the Caribbean and the Netherlands and Ghana. I'm just amazed. And hey, so I was thinking about our coverage of the continents. Is there anybody from South America? We need to know about you if you're there. And from Asia, if there's anybody from Asia. I think the other continents are pretty much represented, except maybe Antarctica. I don't know. Any penguins joining us? Why? Anyway, we're glad you are here tonight, and we're just so moved, Carol and I both, by the interaction that we've had on the Facebook page this week, by your vulnerability, how you've been able to connect with each other, encourage each other, and support each other. And I have to tell you, this has just surpassed all my expectations, this group and the way that you are together. So thank you so much for all that you're doing to make this group what it is. It wouldn't be that way if you weren't. So we're glad that you're here with us. So here's a question. We're going to start with a few fun questions this week. Okay, Carol, it is hot here in North Carolina.
It is hot.
It is really hot and muggy, muggy. So what's the perfect temperature at your house, Carol?
Well, we sort of have a perfect compromise because I'm always cold nature, so I'd probably like it 77, 78 would be fine.
Mm-hmm.
My husband is much lower, so right now our thermostat is set at 75, and it works for both of us.
Okay, that's good. Yeah, we squabble just a little bit over the thermostat, too. We've got it set at 72. So what's the perfect temperature at your house? Is it hot or is it cold? I know some of you that are in the southern hemisphere might be cold. That's such a
great
thing, right?
Yeah.
So, and then the other thing that we want to know from you is, what's your perfect day out with a friend? What do you like to do on your perfect day out? Carol, what do you like to do?
For me, I look for any excuse to eat out. I love to eat out. And also, I hate shopping for clothes. So one of my dear friends loves shopping for clothes, so if I go with her, it actually makes it fun.
Oh, that's good. That's good. Yeah, girls like to shop. I specifically am a cheapskate shopper, and I love to go to thrift stores, so I'm sporting a Goodwill top tonight. Mm-hmm. That may be too much information for some of you. You may be tuning off right
now. She washed it first.
I did wash it first. That's good. Yeah, so we'd love to hear from you. What's your favorite thing to do with a girlfriend when you go out during the day? So I want to launch in tonight in our 15 minutes that we have and start talking about, let me start my little timer over here, start talking about what does it mean to live with God, not just for God. Years ago, probably about 5 or 6 years ago, I was walking to the mailbox one day, and it was just, it had been one of those days. I'm sure you've had them too. I was tired. I felt sort of numb inside. Things have been super busy, and I was just not in a good place. As I walked out to the mailbox, I had this thought. What would it be like to walk away from God? I mean, to walk away from all of it. And I really just let myself think this thought and answer the question, and I thought, well, I get some Sunday mornings back to sleep in, and I could keep 10% of our finances in the bank instead of giving them. And I could spend my mornings a different way instead of sitting down with my Bible and praying. I could, you know, get a little more exercise in, hypothetically. And then I had the thought, too, I even went to this place where I thought, life would be so much easier if I didn't have to struggle against sin. And in that moment, even that felt like freedom. Now, I have to tell you, 6 years ago, I was on the Proverbs 31 speaker team. I was speaking, I was writing, I was deep in ministry. I was teaching our life group at church, our women. And so I was doing ministry, and y'all, I have been a Jesus girl since I was 10 years old. But I still had these thoughts, these doubts, this struggling, like, what would it be like just to walk away from God? Maybe you've had those thoughts too. They're hard to say out loud. Maybe you've never even told anybody that you've had those doubts. But I think if any of us have had struggles or hard times, we probably had that thought. Maybe it was a time when you were going through an unwanted divorce or unwanted stretch of singleness. Maybe it was when you were struggling with infertility. Maybe it was when you had lost a job, or maybe it was when you were hiding all the struggles and the problems that you were having in your marriage within the four walls of your house. It was a secret. Nobody knew. Maybe it was when you were struggling with parenting. You had a prodigal child that was wandering far from home. Maybe it was today. Maybe you had that thought today. Let's just be really real here. Let's be honest. Some days, it's really hard to love and serve an invisible God, a God that we can't experience with our five senses. Some days are really, really hard. But I came to a truth that day, and I knew the truth, which is that when we sink into those disappointments and that disillusionment, that there's usually one root, there's one problem, and it's that we don't know just how much that God loves us. So when we struggle with doubt, and we struggle with disillusionment, and we struggle with disappointment with God, there's one thing that we have to do, and it's not rely on our feelings, because that is so very dangerous. It's to go to God's Word and to see what His Word, the thing that's our rock, the thing that we can stand on, what does it have to say? And tonight, I want to do this little teaching from an extremely familiar passage, and it's John 10:10. And John 10:10, it says, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and may have it to the full." Those letters are in red. That means that it is Jesus speaking to us. And He's telling us that we have an enemy. And that he calls him in this passage the thief. In other places in Scripture, he's called Satan or Lucifer or the devil. He's our enemy, and he comes, and it says, only to steal. That's his main job in our life, is to steal. And I wrote down some thoughts about what is it exactly that our enemy, the thief, steals from us. He steals joy and peace and love. He kills our dreams and hopes and our sense of security. He destroys lives and relationships and true freedom. And when I thought about that thief and that enemy, and then I thought about the lists that we've been reading about this week, the good girl list and the never good enough list, and I thought, that's exactly what my lists have done in my life. If they have stolen, they've killed and destroyed all those things that I've just listed. Like, I might have looked like a pretty happy girl on the outside, and I've had a fairly tragedy-free life, and yet there was this underlying discontent, this underlying feeling of missing something. And you hear that? He stole from me. He destroyed some things. He killed some things in my heart with my list. And when we start realizing what our list, how it's functioned in our lives, and it's functioned as a thief, then we know exactly where that list came from. That list, those lists, the good girl list and the never good enough list, they come from our enemy. And yet Jesus wants to do something very different. So Satan wants to limit our lives to a life for God, a life that's attached to those lists, a life that's a check off, a to-do kind of situation. He wants to limit our lives to that. But Jesus says that he wants to give us life and life to the full. Some translations say life abundantly. He wants to give us life with God. That little preposition with is so important. It's so key because it speaks of relationship. It's not just something that God is this distant person, this project manager in the sky. That was kind of how I had come to view him, is that he was the one holding my to-do list, seeing if I was living up to it or not. And instead of feeling close and connected and with him, Emmanuel, God with us, right, that I just felt like I was just producing for him over and over and over again. And I had gotten to a very, very bad place because of that, a place where I even questioned whether I wanted relationship with him anymore. So I wanted to read to you, because sometimes I love to read the Message just beside my NIV translation. NIV, I think, is a truer translation, but the Message sometimes jolts my brain because I'm a church girl that's heard the scripture so often, and I need a way to like get my brain out of the rut. And so I love it beside, and it says it this way: anyone who goes through me, this is Jesus, will be cared for. Don't you love that? Will freely go in and out and find pasture. A thief is only there to steal and kill and destroy. I came so they can have real and eternal life, a more and better life than they ever dreamed of. That's the kind of life that Jesus wants to give to us. Our lists will never, ever give us life. But living with God, living with Jesus, leaves us with abundant life and gives us abundant life.
Absolutely. And I love how you pointed out that Satan steals, and it's so subtle. And our lists, they feel like the right things, that we're doing good things, but it's just a subtle way that Satan tricks us into kind of following him and not relying on the abundance of God's love.
That is so good. So good. He's tricky like that. And yeah, and it is so subtle, and that's how he gets us with it. So I want to give you an action step tonight. And your action step, and some of you already talked about this on the Facebook page this week, you're already doing it, but your action step is to make two new lists. To make, as you read through scripture, to make a list of God's benefits and of his beautiful characteristics. So I want to give you an example. Psalm 103 is one of my favorite chapters, and I love it because Psalm 103:2 says, "Praise the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits." And then it goes on to list the benefits of God and list things like forgiveness and healing and redemption, and it lists and lists and lists the benefits of serving God. So as you read, whatever you're reading in your Bibles, I want you to make a list of the benefits of serving God. And then I also want you to make a second list of the beautiful characteristics of God. And Exodus 34:6 is one of my favorite passages where God speaks of himself and he lists his own characteristics. And he talks about his compassion and his grace and his kindness and his abounding love for us. And so, in fact, I want to just challenge you to take Psalm 103 and Exodus 34:6 and make a list yourself. Start there. I might ask you on the Facebook page tomorrow what you dug up. So take a look at those. So that day, as I was walking to the mailbox, and I let my mind go all the way to the end of that question, what would it be like to walk away from God? It was Psalm 103 that came to my mind. And I felt like he said that, Amy, don't forget my benefits. And as I started thinking about the benefits of loving God and being loved by God, I realized I can never walk away. Because I've had relationship with him. And I had in the past. I just needed to get back to that place. And when you've had relationship with God, or if you decide to experience it for the very first time, he'll meet you there. He's completely irresistible. You'll never be able to walk away again. And so that was the place that I found myself in. And that's the invitation that I want to extend to you tonight, that I believe Jesus extends to us tonight, And he says to us, lay down your lists so you can experience life. So here's my question to you, because this was a topic of conversation on the Facebook page this week. Which list did you identify with the most? The good girl list or the never good enough list? Or, as some of you said, did you identify with both? So, let me put on my glasses. I brought my glass, my specs, so I could see your answers tonight. So, let's see what some of you have to say about that. The good girl list or the never good enough list?
Never good enough.
Never good enough. Okay.
That's Julie.
Oh.
Both lists?
Both. Oh, you know what? My specs are totally not working. So, never good enough, never good enough, I know. And sometimes people hand you that list or the culture hands you the list. Back and forth in between, yes, the good girl list. And so there's kind of a variety. You could probably tell from the way that I wrote that when I wrote the book, to me, it was so black and white. And to me, I was like the good girl list. But at my launch party, Josie, who you read about in the introduction, was there. And she made the point when we had a little panel discussion that she said, well, I go back and forth in between the lists. And when she said that, it was this light bulb moment for the girl that wrote about the list. Duh. But I thought, so do I. I mean, I'm totally the good girl list when it comes to accomplishments and tasks and things like that. But when I walk into a room of strangers, the never good enough list attacks me. I mean, it's in social situations that I kind of feel like the misfit sometimes. I still struggle with that and have to really deal with that even as an adult. A friend of mine talked about the middle school lunchroom. And doesn't that feel like that even now sometimes, right? And so, Carol, how about you? The good girl list or the never good enough?
I'm definitely the good girl list. We've had a very similar background, and I've always had a list, ideals for what I'm supposed to accomplish and do and be. And so I definitely relate to that one more, though. I definitely can relate to the not good enough girl list. When I read it, there are parts of it that resonate with me. So I think you're right. I think it kind of depends on the situation.
Well, we are so glad that we've been able to be with you live tonight. Holly is going to take over now, and she's going to type out some questions for you. You guys did great last time of participating. And even if you're not here tonight, just know that you are welcome to leave comments. I have been totally fueled by your comments and knowing that this is a community, absolutely, that we're not doing this by ourselves. I think I mentioned last week that as I wrote the book, seriously, I sat behind my computer and thought, nobody else thinks like this. Nobody else is this messed up. Nobody's going to buy this book or understand. And so it's really a comfort to know that we're in a community, not to stay stuck here together and kind of pat each other on the back, but to move forward together out of this place. So thank you so much for being here tonight. And Holly, take it away.
Bye.